The passing scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.
Welcome to the monthly BC TV program titled The Passing Scene, News and Views. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, President Emeritus of the Historical Society of Berks County, and co-compiler of the Passing Scene series of illustrated Reading and Berks histories. Appearing with me on the set today is co-host Tadd Kelby Casner, a president of the Center Park Historic District.
Our friend Larry Soltis of Exeter Township reminds us to inform home viewers that this program will repeat this Sunday, November 10th at 10 p.m., Monday, November 11th at 9 a.m., and next Wednesday, November 13th at 3 p.m. Let me repeat those times. This Sunday, November 10th at 10 p.m., Monday, November 11th at 9 a.m., and next Wednesday, November 13th at 3 p.m. Today's program is a potpourri of Reading and Berks views drawn from a variety of sources, most of which were supplied by friends who share our interests in local history.
But first, Tadd, is there anything you want to report on the Center Park Historic District?
Yes, I have a couple things. This week, today is what, Wednesday? This Friday, November 8th, is our annual fall ball. The fall ball will take place this Friday at 7 p.m. at the Inn at Center Park on the 700 block of Center Avenue, right across from Center Park itself. It's a party, basically. Tickets are $45, and that it's very reasonable, I would say, $45, and that includes the cost of food, beer, wine, non-alcoholic, signature cocktails by Reading Distilling Guild, DJ Journey providing music. We're selling raffle tickets for two luxury gift baskets, and the mansion is a beautiful and historic place. If you haven't been, it's definitely worth seeing. Tickets are limited to 100 people, and they're going fast. We still have some available, and you can purchase tickets for the event at our website, which is www.centerparkhistoricdistrict.org. You can also find us on Instagram and Facebook. The event on Facebook also has a link. You can pay very conveniently via PayPal. And you can also call the Center Park Artifacts Bank as well at 610-375-7860. So that is this Friday. Coming up, our biggest event of the year, if we could go to the graphic that I have, there we have it. On Saturday and Sunday, December 7th and 8th, we are doing our annual Christmas house tour. And on Saturday, December the 7th, is our VIP Moonlight house tour. So if you pay a little extra, tickets are $55, and I believe the VIP tour is limited to only 60 people. You pay $55, and you get to tour the private homes the night before the main tour. You'll be split into groups, and you'll have your own guide, and you'll tour each of the private homes. And after the tour, you will get to go to a beautiful private home for a cocktail party. Food and drink are included in that price. And that event always sells out. So if you're interested, I would definitely act now. The main event is Sunday, December the 8th. And that, of course, is the main Christmas house tour. Tickets are $20 in advance or $25 the day of. And we have a tent in Center Park, right on the 700 block of Center Avenue. We can go to the white tent and buy your tickets. You'll get a tour booklet, and it's a self-guided tour through our historic and beautiful neighborhood. You'll tour six private homes, as well as, I think we usually have a couple churches. We have a holiday gift market as well. It's definitely worth doing. If you have never been to our neighborhood, I highly recommend it. I think you, George, have
numerous times.
Mm-hmm. I think I could be wrong. I feel like this is the, oh God, I don't even know what we're up to now, 37th year.
Is it the 37th?
Christmas house tour. Mm-hmm. Yep. So that is the event, the big event of the season. We also provide convenient parking at First Energy Baseball Stadium if you choose. We have a shuttle bus that runs a continuous circuit throughout the day, so if you want easy parking, you have that there as well. Check us out again, centerparkhistoricdistrict.org, as well as our page, Center Park Historic District on Facebook, and we are at Center Park Historic District on Instagram.
What's that date again for the house tour, for the regular house tour?
Sunday, December the 8th. Sunday, December the 8th from 11 a.m. until 5 p.m.
That's always exceptional.
Very good.
I thank you, Tadd.
You're welcome.
Before we have our our festival of unusual pictures, it's a real scatterdash assortment of photographs, but I think you'll find them interesting. There's very little continuity one from the other. It's just neat pictures that have turned up in more recent times. Frequently, and I received two emails this week about doing research on Berks County history. Anyone interested in doing research on Berks County history, genealogy, always think first of the Historical Society of Berks County or the Berks History Center. Their library is really extremely well organized. It's well indexed, and there's a wealth of material there. One source that people sometimes don't get around to checking into, as a matter of fact, most folks don't realize it exists. I didn't realize myself that it existed until about 10 years ago when a retired jeweler gave me a copy. Used to be on Schuylkill Avenue near Buttonwood Street, gave me a copy of a publication that is really extremely helpful for anyone doing genealogy and people who are interested in the villages, towns, and boroughs of Berks County. I don't know if you can zoom in on this or not. Okay. What it is, it's the Mercantile Agency. That's the name of it. These pop up once in a while on eBay, and they are never inexpensive because libraries like to get a hold of them, and you just rarely ever see them. Some of you people who are old enough will remember that when you were given a telephone book years ago, before they handed you the new one, they wanted you to hand them the old one. Recently they just dropped them on your doorstep or put them along outside your house. But years ago they came to the door and they wanted your old telephone book in exchange for the new one. I guess because of recycling the paper, I would imagine. But in any event, these things were never meant to be kept, these mercantile. It's a mercantile agency reference book. The one that I have lying before me is for January 1899. This is a really early one. And it was published by R.G. Dunn and Company, Broadway, New York. Again, the Mercantile Agency, that's what you check for if you're trying to, bookstores or whatever, although they rarely ever turn up. The reference book and key of the state of Pennsylvania. What makes this interesting, they rate everybody who's listed in this publication. And this covers every business person, believe it or not, in the state of Pennsylvania. Very few people get left out. And they rate people all the way down to double A, can be trusted with a loan or whatever of $1 million, 1899. Wow. Down to, everyone is coded, A, B, C, D, whatever, down to M, less than $500. But anyhow, I'll give you an example. This interested me. Out of curiosity, I was checking the other night. Here's a 1949. Look at the difference in the course of time. 1949 edition, which I just bought fairly recently. And now it's published by Dunn and Bradstreet in Broadway, New York. It says, this is the July 1949 edition. The next edition will be January 1950. So apparently they came out about twice a year. I didn't realize that. So that, again, you don't find these lying around very often at places because they wanted them back. I checked, and I was curious about St. Lawrence. It's St. Lawrence became a borough in 1925. It used to, but the post office for St. Lawrence was Esterley. I looked for St. Lawrence in this 1941 directory, and there was no St. Lawrence. I thought, isn't that strange? It used to be called Esterley, but it was St. Lawrence after 1925. So I discovered that in 1941, they were still calling it Esterley, which I found interesting. In the 1899 edition, just to give you a little bit of an idea of how they list things, for Esterley, Berks County, the banking town is Reading. This I found, here are the business people of St. Lawrence or Esterley. Cyrus Ahrens, St. Lawrence. He was the official bone boiler. Why would you boil bones? Well, the answer is down the page. A.J. Brumbach, woolen mill. People still in St. Lawrence know about the Brumbachs. They were movers and shakers in that area for a long, long time. Brumbach Brothers, manufacturer of woolens. By the way, their prize woolen was St. Lawrence on his horse with the lance. That was their trademark. Then we come down to Joseph Levan. Guess what Joseph Levan was doing? He had the glue factory. So I would imagine that he knew Cyrus Ahrens fairly well, the bone boiler. Then we have Jay Griesemer, who had a flour, feed, and grain mill. That building still stands. It was converted to a dyeing mill. It was St. Lawrence Dyeing in the time that I moved there 50 years ago. That was still in operation. But the old stone part of that was a grist mill, started by the same man who built the American Haas Hotel at 4th and Penn in Reading. He owned both the hotel and that mill. John Lutz, furniture and undertaking. And Darius Widener, the butcher. So that gives you an idea. Oh, by the way, the person best fixed financially, would you believe, was, here's the shocker, Cyrus Ahrens. He had a G rating. And then came J, John Lutz, furniture and undertaking. And Mr. Griesemer's flour mill, he had an M rating. The rest of the people weren't rated, which meant that they were below the scale. So don't go to them for a loan. Anyhow, I wanted you to know that these books exist, and they are really valuable. Every village in Berks County, every village in Pennsylvania, they list everybody who was involved with some sort of business. This is a great source of research. Now, the last time I checked, which is about 15 years ago, the Historical Society had a couple of these, but not many. You just rarely ever see them because you weren't supposed to keep them. How these survived taking back. And while we're on the subject of sources of information, I brought this along. Most people who do research are familiar with the Reading and Berks County Directory, the Reading City Directory, and they also had a suburban directory years ago. I don't know when they stopped publishing them for Reading, but I don't think I have any from Reading after the 1980s. I haven't seen any. They used to be printed at 6th and Penn in the old Reading Eagle printing office. These were put out beginning in 1856, the very first directory for the city of Reading that lists everybody and what their occupation was. Dates from 1856. This is a very rare directory. 1856. And what's very interesting in here is that they have a supplement in the center. And in that supplement in the center, they have a reprint of the 1806 city directory. Very, very interesting. These are very, very rare, needless to say. Not a whole lot of those survived. Anyhow, I want you to be aware of the city directories. The Historical Society of Berks County has a complete run of the city directories. At least, I'm sure they do. The Reading Eagle had a complete run in their library. I'm not so sure they have all of them anymore, but they did have a complete run at one time. Now for some pictures. Again, this we're going all over the county to see these things. Start us off. Okay, the first picture. This, I have a number of pictures from Birdsboro that were lent by John DeAugustine of, I guess, of the Birdsboro area. Lent me a number of photographs that I thought were very interesting. This one is particularly interesting. What we're seeing there is the 46th Regimental Band of Birdsboro, Pennsylvania. Now, we don't know exactly who all those people are, but what makes the photograph interesting is that's a great picture of the entrance to the early schoolhouse that was in Birdsboro. That, of course, does not survive anymore, and there are very few pictures. I don't think I've ever seen a picture of the whole building. All you generally see with like military pictures or band pictures is the front of this building. So what you're seeing there is the very early public school building in the town of Birdsboro. That's John W. Slip, whose dad had a hardware store in Birdsboro. John Slip himself continued the business. There was a nasty fire many, many years ago that destroyed his dad, who died at the age of 65, was a sold hardware, general things like hardware, and he also did some construction from what the obituary said. But this was this was taken in Birdsboro, and I think the date was in the early 1940s. It might have been 1942. Looks like Little Venice standing in the water. Mm-hmm. Next. The people who are in this picture really doesn't matter, but John Slip is one of them. What I found fascinating with this photograph, look at the length of that ambulance. That threw me when I saw that. Can you imagine what the wheelbase is? Can you imagine the distance between the front wheels and the back wheels? I'm surprised it didn't belly in the middle. That's a big vehicle. I have no idea how long they had that. That, I think, again, dates from the 1940s. But what a vehicle that is. I should ask someone down at the Boyertown Museum of Antique Vehicles what they know about such a thing. I've never seen one that long. It was like they took a car and stretched it. Slip's Hardware Store. That's John Slip on the right-hand side. And they sold everything under the sun, including gear for fishing. What we have here is Chapel Rocks. Chapel Rocks in Alces Township lie off Mexico Road. At one time, people who used to go on hiking trips on a Sunday in that general area would either go to Chapel Rocks, there was a little picnic table there at one time, or they went to Chimney Rocks in Loboxville. Those were two favorite places to visit for people. You know, if you look at these old photographs and you have a feeling that the people years ago had more fun on a weekend than we do, you see 15, 20 people all walking together going to these particular sites. This says, inexplicably, the Chapel Rocks of Alces Township once drew hundreds of people each year, many of whom would picnic in the grove here. That grove, by the way, is now off limits. It's on private property, and you are not welcomed with open arms. The site, wildly overgrown when visited in 1960, it was that long ago that I visited. That's 60 years ago. Good God. Lies between Mexico and Basket Roads in the general vicinity of the hamlet of Basket. This view was taken by someone in the botany class of Boys High School in Reading, July the 1st, 1908. If you plan to visit, find your way to Spies Church and then ask an old-timer for directions and go in the wintertime. Correction, don't go. They don't want you in the private property. Next. This one, this picture was taken a little bit later from a different view of Chapel Rocks. That was brought in by someone interested in the history of Alces Township. Alces has that Alces Heritage Society that has been meeting and doing some very good work. They had a splendid banquet about a month ago. It's an up-and-coming historical society or historical group in Berks County. This was one of the pictures in their collection of Chapel Rocks. There we see two people standing on top. You know, that's quite a walk up there. You see them?
Oh, yes.
Take good shoes. Sure. Next. There is John Slip, the fellow who founded the hardware store construction business, Lumber Yard. When they had the fire there, that sort of put the kibosh to the lumber business. Mr. Slip died Thursday, August the 25th, 1921, of a stroke. The article goes on to say he was 64, he was 65. I sort of looked into that, and he died at the age of 65. He was very well affiliated with all the fraternal organizations in the general area, as were most of the old-timers years ago. In the days before television, if you wanted to while away your evening, you went to one of the men's groups that functioned throughout Berks County, POS of A, for instance, or the Knights of the Golden Eagle, any of those groups. Next. This is an interesting picture. This was found among the glass plates by Dr. William A. Heyman, taken in the wintertime. Now, you'd have to walk around a good deal and be very vigilant to find someone walking around in the snow like that with a bag over his shoulder. That was a posed photograph, as were all of Dr. Heyman's pictures. It says Antietam Lake with an arrow pointing to it. That's a neat picture. So he really plagued himself going out in that snow and that slush to get that photograph. The spillway at Lake Antietam, I think that picture dates from the 1930s, I think. That was a photograph that we came across recently and did a little restoration work on it. Next. I forget where I came across this photograph, but it says the Jordan bituminous coal. Bituminous is soft coal as opposed to anthracite, which is hard coal. Locomotives used bituminous years ago. People in their homes used anthracite because it gave a greater heat and was less difficult to deal with. The right coal at the right price. C.R. Bachman Coal Company, Reading, Pennsylvania. Interesting picture. I presume they're, yeah, look at the size of that, the pieces of coal that they're carrying around. That wasn't a particularly clean job. Next.
Just breathing in coal dust.
Breathing in coal dust, you're right. Well, we're back in Alsace Township again. Peter Fee's old hostelry on the Alsace Hills. Peter Fee's Tavern, and you know, you read old newspapers, there was always something going on at Fee's Tavern, which would today be along Antietam Road, not too far from what had been the Alsace Consolidated School, near Spee's Church, the road down to Antietam. The hotel is what you see there on the left-hand side. They used to have military drills there frequently. It was a place where the men got together in the period following the Civil War, and possibly even during the Civil War before. Like men used to get together for their what they called the battalion days, did a little drill work with their rifles and got themselves stone drunk during the course of the day. It says, conducted by himself, the oldest landlord in eastern Pennsylvania, his recollection of military training days, frolics, and fights. Peter Fees, in his 84th year, living in the Alsace Hills, about 6 miles from Reading, the oldest hotel keeper in eastern Pennsylvania. The Eagle used to be very great about the oldest this, the youngest that, the biggest this, whatever. You don't put a whole lot of stock in that. He has conducted the public house there continuously for 60 years. His 61st annual license has just been granted by the court. On eBay about 5 or 6 years ago, one of his licenses for the hotel popped up on eBay. There we see the Black Horse Hotel, commonly called Fee's Hotel. The building still stands, by the way. The inside is an artist's rendering of the interior of the hotel, and that is Mr. Fee's behind the bar. Next. Here is Fee's Hotel as it appears, as it appeared a number of years ago. I had taken a group of school kids for a ride for some of the historic sites in the general area. The former Fee's Hotel retains some of the features discussed in the text, but generally it has been altered measurably inside and outside. It had a very interesting interior. That part of that barn, that barroom, was still around many years ago, and there was a vault like in the wall in the barroom where I guess they kept the liquor enclosed and locked it up. This was the center of a 19th century hamlet that once included a schoolhouse, evangelical church, a grist mill, forge, blacksmith shop. The blacksmith shop, people who are watching this program, probably some of you people will remember the blacksmith shop. At Fee's Hotel, which fronts on Antietam, as you go down towards Antietam on the right-hand side, and right below the hotel was a log building, and that was what remained of the blacksmith shop. A wheelwright shop, which is the log structure. Standing out front were junior historians Scott Robinson, Dan Saltzfus, Avanti Patel, and Del Sharon. Fee's Hotel is located at about 400 Antietam Road. Now, to the immediate right of that was a very old barn, which no longer survives. That was torn away. I must confess, I haven't taken a recent picture of this. This goes back a number of years. Next. Well, we're up at Antietam Lake. Needless to say, it appears that there's an accumulation of snow. The house that you see was the watch house for the fellow who oversaw the Antietam Lake operation and the valve house where the water ran down by gravity into Reading. That house was torn down, what, about a year and a half ago, I guess. That frame building that you see in the picture, that no longer stands. But that was there a long, long time. Next. Well, it looks like we're in Bechtelsville. What you see on the right-hand side is the Union Hotel. That building still stands. And when Thomas Edison came to Bechtelsville years ago, and he came to oversee an operation that was being conducted close by, he had like an iron mine in that general area, and he was experimenting with a method of extracting iron ore from the ore itself. There was a crushing operation, and then the crushed material passed through two very, very powerful, I guess, electromagnets that would draw in the bits of iron, and the rest would just fall through. That wasn't good. It was a very awkward operation. It was never a success. And he commented in later years about how many dollars he dropped down that iron hole. On the left, you see the general store in that area. That operated until fairly recent times. The last time I drove by, it appeared to be like an apartment house, but they had that general store that operated a long, long time. And way in the background, you see a lodge hall. That lodge hall, for a period, housed part of the public school up in the second floor. But that is Bechtelsville. Those buildings all survive in a modified condition in Bechtelsville. Some of the people watching this program should remember this building. This was Salem UB Church. It was one of the old evangelical churches of Berks County. Every village had an evangelical church at one time. If you had 10 houses, you had an evangelical church. Usually they were frame. This one appears to be brick. I remember this building. On Penn Avenue, if you're coming from Wyomissing Hills, you're coming down the hill. At the bottom of the hill, McDonald's would be on the left-hand side. And then on the right-hand side was this church. I remember when they had the last service there, and they abandoned the church, and the church was torn down. Faintly visible on the right-hand side, there was even a little public school there at one time. One-room schoolhouse sat on the left side of that church. Let's see, what is that road that runs up past there? Is that Hull Road? I always forget the name of that road. But at the top of the hill, when you go up that hill past behind the church, there's a cemetery on top of the hill on the left-hand side. That cemetery had to do with the congregation that worshipped here. Again, that was torn. Gee, I bet you that was torn down probably in the 1950s or maybe. I'm sure that was torn down quite a while back. I remember when they were tearing it down. I remember the last service they held there, and then they were planning to tear it down the following week. I don't remember the one-room schoolhouse. That disappeared earlier. Probably when they widened that road going up the hill across the McDonald's.
Oh, yeah.
The one-room schoolhouse left. But the old maps show one-room schoolhouse next to the Evangelical Church. I wonder how many people watching this program remember that building. Next. This was taken from the Penn Street Bridge, and we're looking downstream. In the background, if you look carefully, you see an iron truss bridge crossing the Schuylkill at an angle. That was the trolley bridge. The trolley crossed over there and went over to Lancaster Avenue. When they built the new Lancaster Avenue bridge, then the trolley tracks went over the new bridge opened, the cement one that's still there today, about 1921 or so. And then that was no longer used. But that was a trolley bridge across the Schuylkill. Again, we're looking downstream. We have to thank our friend Larry Soltis from Exeter Township for this photograph. This is an absolute gem. This was made from a glass lantern slide. Glass lantern slides were 3 1/4 by 4 inches. They were the old time slide. Most of us remember the 35 millimeter slides. Well, before that, they had 4 by 5 slides. Interestingly, Kodak still manufactured glass plates for slides into the 1960s. As a matter of fact, I have a catalog at home that I got from Kodak about 1966, and they still listed boxes of 10 glass lantern slides for making pictures. Now, the color. Someone asked me, is that color original? No, the answer is no. When you look at that thing, you realize that some soul was working with dyes or paints. And in some cases, they had 1 or 2 bristles on the brush to paint in those details. Whoever did that did a masterful job.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's coming down the Schuylkill from the right over to the left. The boats exited on the left side. Now, where was that lock house? That was at Big Redding Dam on the Schuylkill River. To try to locate that site today, you would probably go to Forest Hill Cemetery and drive through the cemetery to the very back of the cemetery. Then you walk through a culvert. Have you ever done that?
Yeah, yep.
You've done that. Mm-hmm. Walk through the culvert and look across the Schuylkill. And what you see across the Schuylkill, years ago, you would have seen exactly that by looking across the Schuylkill from that culvert at Forest Hill Cemetery. Big Redding Dam was there. On the right-hand side, you see part of the dam. For a while, they were making hydroelectric there to operate the Neversink Mountain Railroad. That was never successful, because they couldn't count, especially in the summertime when the customers came in large numbers to ride the trolley, they could never get enough power to operate more than one car at a time, and then it was very iffy. What they did was they built a power plant on the Forest Hill side of the cemetery. They built a power plant there that operated until the flood of 1941, when the plant was washed away. In the latter days, they used that to manufacture direct current to operate the trolleys in the city of Reading, or one of the places to operate the trolleys. That's a really unusual photograph. That, to me, was the gem of the collection. You recognize that?
Is that Yellow House?
That's Yellow House, yep. Now, the original Yellow House Hotel is not what you're seeing there. What you're seeing there dates from the Civil War period. The original Yellow House Hotel is that little back portion on the right-hand side. As we're looking at this picture, back on the right-hand side is a small portion of that building, which was the original Yellow House Hotel, which dates from 1801. Funny story about that. Years ago, Gloria and I were driving through the area, and we decided to stop for the Yellow House Hotel for lunch, which we did. They handed us a menu, and on the menu in the front, it said Yellow House Hotel since 1865. I said, you know, this is a much older operation than 1865. And Mr. Nagel opened that thing in 1801. I was told that this was 1865. So bottom line was, he didn't believe me. Those days I was writing for the Reading Eagle. I went home and I wrote a big story on the hamlet of Yellow House with the hotel. And the headline in the Reading Eagle, right across the top first page of the second section, was Yellow House dates from 1801. The following Saturday, Gloria and I were going down to Gilbertsville to the auction. And as we went down, we saw a fellow up on a ladder with a paintbrush, changing the date from 1865 to 1801. And today that sign says 1801. But that's the Yellow House Hotel. Some of us, again, might remember that on the left-hand side, as you look at that picture, I guess there's a wagon there in front.
Yes.
Yeah. That was the post office and the general store. I went there the last day of the Yellow House Hotel post office, and I got a last day cancellation. Now that post office and the general store operation has been taken in, and it's all part of the interior of the hotel now. I guess you can actually eat in that general section today. Mm-hmm. Yellow House Hotel dates from 1801. What I found fascinating in going through that building years ago was that the back portion, the 1801 portion, is it was built, I'm sure, by the same fellow who built our house. Our house dates from 1804. And the doorway, the entrance to the second floor, all the woodwork is exactly the same as what you see there in the original part of the Yellow House Hotel. 1801, our house was 1804. I'm positive it was put up by the same contractor, the same builder. Next. Interesting picture. P.M. Ziegler, his drugstore, 526 Penn Street. In my time, there was a woman's clothing store at that address. Was it True Fine or Fine something? The name escapes me for the moment. But that's long gone. If you look at the soda fountains in those days, many of them in the fine drug stores, every drug store had a soda fountain. And the fine soda fountains were made of silver, and they're always neatly kept shine up. And you can see the top of that thing sort of served as a lamp in the bargain with a nice tasseled shade. But I remember some of those old drugstores were had fantastic woodwork and with shelves and drawers all over the place. I remember Stewart's drugstore at the corner of West Olley and Schuylkill Avenue. Mr. Stewart had a drugstore that looked very much like that. The woodwork was fantastic. Hundreds of drawers all over shelving ran the full length of the building on Schuylkill Avenue. I don't know what's in that site today, but that was very typical of the old-time drugstores. The White House. Years ago, you would take the White House Hill, you'd go out North 9th Street, from Penn Street, go out North 9th Street, you pass the Reading Brewery there as you begin to climb the hill. And as you climb the hill, that used to be called the White House Road, that went up the hill, down the hill, you made a turn, you crossed the Poplar Neck Covered Bridge, and you wound up on what today would be 724. The Poplar Neck Bridge was replaced years ago by a cement bridge that's there today. It took its place, and you would wind up at the driveway leading into the Animal Rescue League. But that was the old White House Road. The old White House Hotel is in the trees there on the right-hand side. And on the left-hand side was the White House spring. If you go to that site today, of course, there's nothing. 25 or 30 years ago, let me see, 40 some years ago, I went back there, and on the right-hand side, the pillars that suspended the back part of the old White House Hotel were still there, overgrown with weeds, but the pillars were still there, and you can mark the site of where that White House Hotel was. On the right-hand side, on the bottom was the spring. They sold spring water there. If you go to that site today, you climb the hill, up the 9th Street Hill of the White House Road, you still see part of the wall leading to where that spring was. As a matter of fact, when I went by there a number of months ago, you could still see water running out from the side of the hill at that particular site. Originally, it was just a plain spring, and at some point, they added that pavilion on top of the spring, and people could sit up there and dine. They would bring food over from the hotel across the road, the White House Hotel. This I thought was interesting. Uncle Jack and Mary Lou's Park, Sunday, August the 13th, I don't know what year that was, Old Dominion Barn Dance, Sunshine Sue, Cousin Crazy Joe Mathis, and Merrill Travis. That name sounds familiar. A cast of 15 stars. Himmelreich's Grove. Himmelreich's Grove would be on the road, well, on 422 leading into Wilmelsdorf. Before you get into Wilmelsdorf on the left-hand side, there's a road that goes up. There's no Himmelreich's Grove there anymore, but there are some homes built in that property on that land where the Himmelreich's Grove used to be.
Did we skip one? There we go.
Okay, this I thought was a nice picture. Now, this is not unfamiliar to most people. By the way, in the background, you see part of a sign for the John Hay cigar. John Hay cigar was made in Reading. The old tower that burned in 1923, and of course, Schwartz's Summit House Hotel in the background. I watched them tear that down in October of 1959. That was torn down. And prior to its demolition, they had a TV station in there. I think it was CBS had a TV station in there. They had used to do some shows. They had dances up there, PAL dances for a while. And they for a short time, they broadcast television programs from up there. This has no direct bearing to Berks County history at all, but when I saw this, I thought this is just too good to forget about. A picture was taken by the City Gallery. City Gallery was in a three-story building at 5th and Penn on the southwest corner near the old Far Shoe Store building. It was a big three-story building, and in the top floor, they had a photographic gallery, and that's where that picture was taken. Those fellas do look remarkably alike, don't they?
They do.
They were two brothers.
Gosh.
Who maintained their sartorial elegance into old age.
Yes.
This was labeled John Cook's Duck Farm in Topton. I did some checking and I didn't find anything on here. I should have called my good friend, Ramaley from Kutztown, because he was from originally, Dave was originally from Topton. A lot of ducks there.
Yes, indeed.
I'd never seen that picture before. I should do some more research on that. I'm just curious. But that's a new one on me. That building still stands. Can you picture that one?
I believe so.
On the Douglas Turnpike. When you go from the Yellow House Hotel on the old road leading into Douglasville,
on the left-hand side,
that was the old toll house. There were two. I'm aware of two toll houses. Although supposedly there was a small one near the Yellow House Hotel across the street. I've never found anything to substantiate that, but I'm told that there was one there. I knew of two toll houses. This one. And as you approach Douglasville and that shopping mall on the right-hand side, There's a tool house road that leads off from there, and that the other tool house sat exactly the same plan, same design, sat on the left-hand side right on the corner. They tore it down because they said they wanted to do something with that lot. Well, they tore it down and did absolutely nothing with that lot. It's a pile of weeds today. But I remember years ago driving by, and I said to Gloria, I'm going to stop and take a picture of that. Now, today it's changed quite a bit. That there's no picket fence on the right-hand side, and the porch has sort of been bricked in partly. And I was taking a picture, and the lady came on and said, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm interested in tool houses. I'm taking a picture. She said, well, it's not a tool house anymore. Get out of here. So I bid her good day and drove away. Oh, yes, I took her off my prayer list. Mm-hmm. Major John Swartz. He was born in 1793, and along with Simon Seifert, you know, the village of Seifert down there near Gibraltar, with Simon Seifert, built the Mount Penn Furnace up on Valley Stream Road. When you go along 724, you pass the Animal Rescue League on the left-hand side, you're heading sort of over into Shillington, and you come to the Proserpe home, the nice big stone home on top of the hill, and there you have Valley Stream Road. Well, if you go up Valley Stream Road today, now the course of that road has been changed a little bit as you go up to the golf course is up there, I guess.
I forget.
Yeah. Anyhow, there's a golf course up there. When you go up that road, the Mount Penn Furnace used to lie on the left-hand side. Now, the road, again, had changed course somewhat over the years. But I remember when I first learned about the Mount Penn Furnace, it's because we have two Mount Penns. This one is in Cymru Township. When you go up that hill, I looked for the foundations, and I could find absolutely nothing of the Mount Penn Furnace. Then I discovered later on in doing some research that the nuns, God bless them, from Mount Alvernia, completely, with the help of other people, tore down the Mount Penn Furnace, took absolutely every stone, carted it away to Mount Alvernia. And when you go to see the oldest building there at Alvernia College or University, whatever it is today, you look at the oldest building, the foundation up about 8 or 9 feet, it's all brown stone. And all that brown stone in that foundation of the oldest building in Alvernia is the stone from the Mount Penn Furnace. That's why I could find nothing of the Mount Penn Furnace. They absolutely took every last stone. He ran for Congress, by the way, in 1858, and he was in Washington, D.C., and he dropped dead of jaundice in 1860. And that was the end of John Swartz, 1793 to 1858. Excuse me, 1860. He died 2 years after he was elected to Congress on the Democratic ticket. Sunshine Brewery, tearing it down. That was on the front page of the Sunday Eagle. Leroy Gensler, who was a friend of my dad's and was very nice to me when I was a kid, was the Eagle artist. And he would always do these fancy, cutesy covers for the Sunday Eagle magazine section. And this was tearing down the Sunshine Brewery. People watching this program who remember the Sunshine Brewery, it looks to me like there's a clock up there, and I don't remember a clock on top of the Sunshine Brewery. Maybe I just never noticed, but I don't remember a clock up there. And that was, they tore that down in August of 1973. I was on the other side of the Schuylkill River. I was 73. I was teaching in West Reading at the time, and I ran over at lunchtime, and I took a couple of pictures across the Schuylkill. That was in 1973. A while back. Next. This I thought was interesting. This was on eBay, I think. Earl Gross, the State Hill Beer Garden, Dine and Dance, well-known orchestras every Saturday night, lunches, dinners, suppers, 6 miles west of Reading, Sinking Spring, RD number one. You go past the Berkshire Mall up State Hill Road. At the very top of the State Hill Road, on the left side, was the State Hill Beer Garden, which no longer survives. I think that burned. I have a recollection I never saw the remains of it. I never got up there after that, but that no longer survives. Maybe someone watching can tell us indeed what the disposition of that building was, but it doesn't exist anymore. They have something else on that site today. Absolutely gorgeous postcard. That was Samuel L. Smucker, the artist. The Smucker family, by the way, it's the very same family as Smucker peanut butter and Smucker's preserves today that you see in the stores. They started out in the city of Reading. Mr. Smucker's dad was Dr. Smucker, Elhanan Zucker, Zook Smucker. I'll try that again. Elhanan Zook Smucker, born in 1846, was the dad of this artist. They had the hotel at 6th and Penn, which was bought by the Reading Eagle Company. And then when the Reading Eagle moved over from Penn Street to 4th and Court, that building was torn down to make way for, was that Grant's Five and Dime on that corner, 6th and Penn. But that was the Smucker. Dr. Smucker, a graduate of Hahnemann Hospital, had his office right next to what we know as the Medical Arts Building on North 5th Street. The parking lot on the left-hand side was where his office had and home had been. That Samuel Smucker was a fabulous artist. His postcards go for big bucks these days. He had a sister, Catherine, who lived in a very old age in a little farmette in Ole. I went over there years ago, and she put a book out. She taught art at Girls High School, his sister. They were very artistic, both of them. And she wrote a book about her collies. And I have a copy of that book at home that she had given me. Which that's a long, long time ago. How much time do we have, gentlemen?
3 minutes, I think.
Okay, we can see one or two more. The Penn Valley Hotel at Skull Hill. I visited that Skull Hill. There was a post office in there years ago from 1887 to 1904, and Mr. Bagginstose was the first postmaster. The Penn Valley Hotel at Skull Hill, Penn Township. The landmark hotel located on the south side of Irish Creek Road, where Skull Hill Loop conjoins, there is a loop that goes through there, has had a history of operation and inoperation. When last conducted as a hotel in the mid-1980s by Cheryl and Rocky Dendler, the place was known as the Penn Valley Coach House. Under their proprietorship, some restoration was done to provide a nice restaurant section for seating 75 to 100 patrons. Years ago, according to Gertrude Hoffman, parts of the structure were used for bingo, Sunday school, a gas station, and an ice cream parlor. And yes, there was a lot of square dancing here. For the record, Skull Hill was named for Nicholas Skull, Surveyor General of the Province of Pennsylvania from 1748 to 1761. The Historical Society of Berks County, in their archives, has a number of original skull maps, hand-drawn in its permanent collection. The former Penn Valley Hotel in July of 1991 is the picture that you see as an inset. I took that picture in 91.
We can jump ahead there.
I think we'll stop at that point.
All right. Well, I want to remind our home viewers that this program does repeat this Sunday, November the 10th at 10 p.m., Monday, November 11th at 9 a.m., and next Wednesday, November 13th at 3 p.m. On behalf of George M. Meiser the 9th and myself, Tadd Kelby Casner, thank you for watching.
The Passing Scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.